Hi, my name is Scott Campbell, and I am going to talk to you about how we at ESnet have been using Zeek in kind of defending and operating our management network. So kind of a brief outline of what it is that I'm going to talk about. First, I'll explain kind of who ESnet is and what ESnet 6 is and what we do, and then some design patterns as far as, you know, kind of some fundamental things that we applied to building the network and designing it, and then some brief digression into IPv6 shenanigans. Nothing to do with the Microsoft problems of today, but that is kind of interesting. Then I'll briefly go over sinkholes, what they are, and then kind of sinkholes in how we are going to how we use them, and then some mechanics that we built into our POP networks, and then a brief slide or two on how we use policy to model expected behavior. So who we are. ESnet is a Department of Energy science facility, and essentially what we do is connect together all over the globe a variety of DOE labs and sites and supercomputing facilities and all of this CERN over in Europe. And we provide extremely high bandwidth, high reliability, high performant connectivity. So if you have terabytes of data to move around, we can do it quickly and efficiently. What ESnet 6 is a next generation network. So we are redesigning our network from the ground up, taking an optical network that we purchased or acquired a few years back, and kind of building off of that. And it's a really, really cool project. So what we do is essentially, besides kind of assisting our partners, is we move a lot of data. And we broke the exabyte barrier last year. So in 2019, we moved just over an exabyte of data, and we don't see that changing in any way, shape, or form. So we need to be, we need to be really good at moving data. That's what we do. So design patterns. In architecting the security for ESnet 6, there was a handful of really basic design patterns that we applied to as many components of it as possible. And relative to this talk, the first two are really the important ones. And the first idea is that we control the network, which is, hopefully true, yes. But in doing that, we get to decide where high value activities, the traffic for them go. And in doing so, we can build choke points and look for hostile or, bad behavior. And then the other piece is that we decouple data gathering and the analysis of it. And that's because, attackers are super flexible, and we have to have the same kind of flexibility because things change rapidly. And it's kind of interesting is the design pattern one, its origin story. I mean, it's always been something that we have used, but Swift on security in the Twitter feed, there was a tweet that beautifully summarized what it was, and here it is, and it was wonderful because it was like it was kind of an agreement for our design pattern one, which I thought was kind of awesome. So I had to put it up there. So the management net itself, it's just a tiny piece of a larger security architecture. And obviously I'm not going to wander through this entire diagram and go through each of the bits and pieces, but the management net lives in a very tiny sliver of it. And so while we're going to be talking about the needs and designs and solutions we've had for a variety of security problems, it just sits in kind of a sandwich of a whole variety of other things, each of which require the same level of detail and the same level of design. And it's a fascinating architecture problem, but you are there. You are at the pink arrow, right in that layer sandwich there. So I wanted to put that there to kind of provide some kind of context as far as where you sit in the larger architecture. So the management net itself, spent 5 minutes kind of providing some background. So what is it? In an ISP, the management network is really kind of the command and control layer for all of the inter-routing communications at all of the variety of layers. And so it's really important. And in so, it has to be isolated from the rest of the internet. You don't want people being able to SSH into your routers or to throw random packets at the control plane or the management net or anything, because that's just foolishness. So it has to be isolated from the rest of the network. And at least in ESnet, we typically use real addresses for everything. So, allocated address space. And because the management net sits in a fairly large block, we want to keep it in the global routing table, because what happens is if you don't put, if you decide, we'll just not announce the management net to the global routing table, somebody will notice it and somebody will hijack it, and that will cause countless problems for everyone. And so we need to keep it in the routing table, but we also need to protect it. And we could just put a gigantic filter on it, but then you would really lose visibility into behaviors. And I'll kind of go into that. So as far as like what sinkholes are and why they're such wonderful things. A key component is no user or site data moves across the management net, because it kind of sits below all of that, which makes monitoring it a whole lot easier. And the other really sweet thing from a security perspective is there aren't a lot of humans on it doing human things like web browsing and shenaniganizing. So keeping an eye on it is a lot easier, because unexpected behavior or hostile behavior or attacks or broken things tend to stand out a lot better than they do on your standard enterprise network. And we completely use that to our advantage. What it looks like, this is, you can kind of, if you imagine the first slide that I used to describe what ESnet is, this is kind of an overlay onto that. And each of the blue dots is a location that we will drop monitoring equipment in. So essentially at each blue dot, we will have a Zeek instance monitoring the network there and the management network there. And so there's a bunch of them, they're scattered all over the United States. And so it's kind of a distributed monitoring problem, which is really kind of fun and interesting. The red dots are just other locations that don't have, there's either no space to put our gear, or there's not enough utility to put it there. And the yellow dots are just places where there's just optical gear and nothing else. So IPv6, something we're probably talking a lot about today due to the problems with the Microsoft vulnerability. But for our management net, there was a decision that it's going to be IPv6 everywhere. And it's kind of us eating our own dog food, in that we are gigantic advocates of IPv6 usage. And so, if we need to use it too. From a monitoring perspective, the IPv6 address mechanics and kind of the protocol mechanics are a lot more complicated than V4. In that you see vastly more multicast and normal traffic. And what it does is completely unexpected if all you've ever seen is IPv4. And then there's a lot of link local traffic for local subnet communication. So you use link local multicast, usually almost all ICMP, rather than broadcast traffic. And that makes a lot of the policy a little bit more complicated. How that falls onto Zeek and security monitoring is normal, kind of what you expect in normal address scan detection and host tracking tends to be a little bit fuzzier. And because of all this, we built a certain amount of IPv6 policy scaffolding to do kind of protocol analytics to make sure that the IPv6 we see is behaving in ways that it ought to be, to look for kind of layer two attacks. And this is just kind of a list of a bunch of new notices that we integrated into our solution and will presumably be releasing publicly shortly once we make sure that it all works out well. And just, you know, some basic mechanical things, router solicitations you expect to see, but if it's not a, just for the first one, for example, if it's not a multicast in the multicast address space, that's a problem and someone's doing something they're not supposed to, or something that's terribly broken. Take your pick. In either case, it's something that we really want to see. I'm not going to go through all these. I have very little time. And so I will move on, but this is just kind of a sampling of some of the mechanical modeling we did for IPv6 and what we expect to see. So sinkholes, that's a big piece of what it is that we're using in our architecture. And, but like, what is a sinkhole, right? So essentially it's just a place where your, where a subnet's traffic goes if you don't have anywhere better to put it. So it's essentially, just like the name says, it's kind of like the lowest place where addresses go. And so normally you use BGP to kind of announce, hey, this is where this subnet's traffic should go. And then if there's a more precise way to describe where it should go, so like a tiny subnet within a larger subnet, then that will win and it will go there. But otherwise, traffic ends up at a sinkhole when you don't have a better place to put it. And as far as our management net goes, we run a sinkhole both inside of it and outside of it, and each does kind of a separate thing, and I'll cover both cases. The way we're running it now is, you know, essentially, is certainly on the outside. If you just sinkhole traffic, everything goes to that IP and dies because there's no interaction. And so TCP does all of its normal stuff. And essentially you get, you run it at Zeek, you see what's going on from like a packet information perspective. But optionally what you can do if you have a lot of time is you can put a honeypot there and interact with the traffic and communications and get kind of non-radiation information, which is kind of really cool. That is not what we're doing right now, but it is something that we are thinking about doing in the future. That's a nice way of acquiring information about what people are trying to do. So the first sinkhole I'm going to talk about is the external sinkhole. So this is just so kind of the management net. You can just think of it as a subnet like many others. And we're announcing it into the global routing table, and you've got R1 there saying, you know, come over here. This is where the management net lives. And rather than passing the traffic along to the management network like it normally would, it just, anything that heads for the management net, it just tosses it at the sinkhole. And the Z there is our Zeek instance ready and waiting to analyze and record whatever it is that we see. And so when a packet comes in, the red dashed arrow, router one just kind of says, ah, aha, to the sinkhole. And it tosses it in there and we analyze it and record it and everything's good. So essentially the traffic can't get to the management network and we get to see what's happening. And so win-win. And it's in the global routing table to prevent hijacking. Now looking at internally what's going on, is it's kind of a different scenario because there's stuff that's supposed to be happening and stuff that isn't. And so you can think about it in terms of a network garbage can where it is the place where unknown traffic ends up. So you kind of have a data center, you've got your POPs over here, which is a point of presence, which is just like a little data center location. And they all talk amongst themselves and it's all good because they each have their little subnets and their little subnets are in the routing tables and it's all good. But what happens with traffic that doesn't have a better location, say, you know, someone's scanning, for example, either at the data center or a POP or something, if you hit a place that isn't already allocated and advertised, it ends up at the sinkhole. So if you're scanning, it's going to be really noisy because we're not going to generally see anything there. And suddenly it's going to light up and we'll know that something unexpected or unusual is happening. And if you can identify a scanner pretty quick, that suggests that there's a problem somewhere within the internal network. And so thinking about sinkholes in the context of kind of your classic network garbage can. It's also can be thought of as a signal amplifier. But that's kind of the two general designs we're thinking about using for sinkholes within the management net. The POP locations themselves, the points of presence, you know, kind of you could, the colo facilities. Essentially, you have a router, and then you have different kinds of equipment. You have out-of-band equipment to connect when all the smoke leaks out of the network. You have compute infrastructure, you have optical gear, you have a bunch of stuff. All that's connected to a router. We also have a Zeek instance that's connected to the router. The router has a spanning port for everything that's connected to it. And these are all low bandwidth, just kind of small connection equipment. And so the volume of traffic is gonna be fairly tiny because it's all just kind of management traffic, right? You know, SSH logins, route updates, that sort of thing. So there's a spanning connection on the router. So any traffic that passes between these general classes of systems, Zeek sees, and we can write, you know, policy to suggest that, you know, if we see communication that we don't expect, then we get a notice. In addition, a router has ACLs, which kind of limit, you know, this area can talk to that area over this port or whatever. If an ACL denies, rather than just dropping the traffic, it forwards it on to the Zeek instance as well. And so if we're seeing traffic that is not supposed to be happening, it will kind of light up right away. And this is super useful, not only in terms of kind of security monitoring, but as in addition, monitoring things that are broken or misconfigured. If something is throwing traffic in a way that it's not supposed to, it will show up in the Zeek logs right away, and we'll be able to contact the engineering folks and, you know, figure it all out. This general architecture is spread across 37 individual locations across the US. And so kind of data aggregation is kind of an issue as well. So we essentially take all of the data that comes off of our Zeek instances and toss it into Splunk, where we do kind of metadata analysis on it. And do some policy searching as well. So that's how we're handling this. I have 2 minutes, yay. The last little bit is just kind of a quick restatement about the management net. You know, things we take into consideration. The fact that there aren't a lot of humans on there is really awesome from a security perspective. You know, no one is browsing the web. No one is doing weird application stuff. That said, it's, you know, it's a low likelihood of compromise, but any compromise is super high risk. And so you have to build things really carefully and not become kind of worn out over false positives. And then the other interesting piece is, you know, like I said, we take the Zeek logging and drag it back to the backend system in the data center. And the thing that I was going to talk about, but don't have enough time to, and didn't have enough time, and I knew I wouldn't, is essentially we write policy to model expected behavior in systems and processes, business systems and business processes, so that we know when something is kind of out of model. And that's it. Those are the end of my slides. And so if there are any questions, I believe I will be in one of the Slack chat rooms, and that's it. So thank you for listening, and have a good day.